Welcome to Alleluia on this first day of autumn 2024. It is so good to begin a new ministry year with you. We worship with a lot of you this morning, and the choir had a break for good reason. We have a program with a lot of wonderful, powerful repertoire that we wanted to save for this time and place. Many of it is by our artist in residence, Dan Forrest, who's at the piano with us tonight. But many of it are classics that you may not have heard for a while, some from the 1800s, some earlier. We're so excited to share some of this beautiful music with you, and we want to encourage you, if you could silence your cell phones to minimize any extra noise or beeping, any extra music that would be added to the symphony would be diminished. We're so glad you're with us tonight, and that first psalm is a powerful reminder that God is worthy of our praise. It is good for us to praise him for that reason. And it's also a good reminder that praising him is good for us. It is what we were designed to do, to sing his praises. And at the end of the program, you'll have a little chance to even join our voices for the second to last anthem. But until then, we want to take you on a journey, and we want to go up to the heavens. The next two anthems remind us that God created the heavens, because they are telling his glory. And then the anthem after that, Where Can I Go, is based on Psalm 139, which reminds us, if I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths of the sea, behold, even you are there with us. So we hope you can join us now for this journey and allow your mind to be brought to life from these words from Scripture, from Psalm 19 and Psalm 139.
Brahms wrote his Requiem around the time of our country's civil war. And he wrote it after the death of two of his close people in his life. One was Robert Schumann, a fellow composer, and the other was his mother. And his Requiem was very different, because at that time, most of the Catholic Requiems were prayers for the dead, mostly focusing on the coming judgment. And he decided to choose his favorite passages of comfort from Luther's Bible. And it's an astounding work. If you've never listened to Brahms' Requiem, it's some of the most gorgeous, lush harmonies. This movement that you just heard is the central movement, the fourth, in this gorgeous work. And the preceding movements are about sorrow for those that are left behind after the death of a loved one. And then all of a sudden, in this movement, he takes us to the courts of heaven, the courts of the Lord, and he gives us a vision of the hope that we have for those of us that are in Christ. An incredible piece. And we want to remember two loved ones, specifically tonight, that were a part of our community for a good while. One of them, Bill Brown, passed in November of last year, and Diane Fawcett, a soprano who passed in February of this year. And tonight we're going to sing an anthem in memory of both of them. We're so happy to be able to remember them tonight with music that reflects their lives and their faith. The first piece we're going to do now is called Forever King. It's a fast-flying, energetic piece, just like Bill. I was remembering as I was walking in here today that a year ago, Bill was the one that said at last year's fall concert, can we add some color in here? And so he came in with me and Dave McMillan and added some color to our sanctuary, which was much needed, and it's still there. So we thank Bill for all of the color that he added to our lives. A personal memory, I went to the Holy Land with him in fall of 2022, a life-changing trip to walk where Jesus walked, to understand the Bible, not just geography, but to experience that culture. It was very moving, and I got to do it with Bill, which was always an adventure. We had so much fun singing rounds through Hezekiah's tunnel that Hezekiah built under the walls of Jerusalem. We had a kind of a interesting fizzle-out version of the next anthem you're going to hear. On the shores of Galilee, where the keyboard wasn't delivered or was broken, I can't remember, by the rental company. And Dan went over and started playing the Glockenspiel, and we kind of fell apart a little bit, the choir, on the shores of Galilee, but it didn't matter. We remember the one who walked on water, and then we had a hymn sing, and it was a very moving time. But Bill was such a positive and energetic person, so we remember him tonight with Forever King. Diane Fawcett was a longtime member of the choir and this church, and we love their family. She got a diagnosis of colon cancer when I first came, and they gave her 4 months to live from when I came. She lived for 5 years and sang almost every Sunday in spite of pain and discomfort and a lot of symptoms from chemo. Her faith was incredible to witness, how she served so joyfully. And the final time that we were with her was 3 days before her death. She said, it's time, could you invite the choir over? So 25 of us huddled in, and we had a most wonderful hymn sing and prayer time with her as she lay on the couch next to Lyman and Matthew. And she was talking with us, and she perked up when she said, could you do one of my favorite hymns? What God ordains is always good. And I said, yes, and do you know who wrote a version of that that we need to sing? Dan Forrest. I said, we're gonna do that in your memory, Diane, so we'd like to do that hymn tonight as well. What God ordains is always good. In spite of suffering and death and pain and all the travails of this world, we know that we have a good God that works all things for the good of those who love him, to those who are called according to his purpose. So enjoy two very different personalities of pieces for two wonderful personalities that are in the courts of heaven awaiting us. And we remember Bill Brown and Diane Fawcett, and we thank their families, both of them, for coming tonight.
Forever.
I think that setting of Alleluia by Randall Thompson has almost every mood for Alleluia that you can find. And that's a good reminder that we give our praise to God even in the midst of difficulties, and sometimes it's a minor feel, and sometimes it's out of lament and yearning. He wrote that as a commission where Randall Thompson was asked to write a fanfare for a large music festival, and it was just as World War II was beginning. And all he had was a broken Alleluia, and he had to dismiss the idea of brass and fanfare, and instead wrote an a cappella piece that he said could be learned in 1 hour by a young choir, which it took us a little longer than that. It must have been a very good choir that he wrote that for originally back in 1940. But one of the most gorgeous settings of just two words, many, many Alleluias, and then a final amen. We love that piece. And our second to last selection, we're gonna ask for your participation. You can stay seated, and I'll have you sing from your seats for the first few verses, and then I'll stand you for the final last verse. This was a wonderful song, anthem, that Dan Forrest wrote for the 50th anniversary of our denomination last year when we turned 50. And it's a regal and energetic setting that quotes, "O God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come."
Thank you for joining us tonight. Music making is always about sharing. If all we do is rehearse and sing for ourselves, I suppose we've shared with each other a little bit, but it's much more satisfying for us to be able to share with you. And for me, as a composer writing music, I have to share ideas with the choir before they can then share them with you. So there's all this sharing that goes on, but it's a delight to put this together, and thank you for supporting us so well this afternoon. There's one more piece we'd like to sing for you before we all go, which is called No Night There. The text is in your program at the bottom of the last page there. I wrote this at the end of 2022. And those of you that are from Mitchell Road may remember that we did a Bible read-through that year as a church. So we had this kind of weird confluence of events in December of 22, where it was Advent and it was Christmas, and we were somehow preaching through Revelation, which didn't quite seem to fit at the surface. But as Andy worked his way through Revelation and got to the end, it started to make sense more and more, and there were all these beautiful connections that started to show up between the incarnation and the end of all things in Revelation. I don't often write my own texts. I normally set other people's texts to music, but in this case, this scripture came together so well, and I heard music in it and wanted to share it. There are several passages of scripture that are reflected here, just a couple of them, so that you can kind of make these connections. If you think about the word Emmanuel, which, as you know, means God with us, that's in the very first chapter of the New Testament. They shall call his name Emmanuel, which is God with us. But it's not just Christmas, right? Jesus' final words on earth at the end of Matthew 28 are, "Behold, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age." So Emmanuel bookends the book of Matthew. And then it bookends the New Testament, because in the very final chapters of Revelation, it says, "Behold, the dwelling place of God is with us. He will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God." So there's all these beautiful connections of God is with us. God is also for us. In Psalm 118:6, "The Lord is on my side. I will not fear." God's posture towards his children is not away from us or ever against us, but always for us. And if God is for us, then who can be against us? And even in the valley of the shadow of death, it says in Psalm 23, we do not need to be afraid, because he is with us. Then as we worked our way through the Christmas story, I started to see that every main character in the incarnation, in the story of Christ's coming, was told, "Do not be afraid." Zechariah, "Do not be afraid." Mary, "Fear not." Joseph, "Don't be afraid to take Mary." Shepherds on the hillside, "Fear not." All of these trembling and fearful people are told by the messenger of God himself, not more fear, but comfort and words of hope, "Fear not." And then the last main phrase in the piece and the title, "No Night There," is taken from Revelation, where God promises us a renewed heaven and earth, that there will be no night there, no crying, no pain and death, that these are all gone forever. And then in one of the most tender phrases in all of Scripture, God himself wipes away every tear from our eyes. So take heart. God is with us. God is for us. Do not be afraid.